Well, actually, I okay, I said it was better. That on one hand, the powerful network that connects with other schools. But then also, like, the distractions and not a replacement for the
Hey, let's get started here.
That's something I need.
Hey, so this is the problem that we were doing last time. Okay? So as you probably may realize, I stepped it up here, bro. Right? This material is definitely more challenging, at least from past experience. Especially in the beginning, but then it settles down afterwards. After you figure out how to do this stuff. So, what we were doing here is that we were looking at this example 8.2, and this is what the original circuit looks like. And what we were wanting to do here is that we wanted to calculate the current IX. How do I calculate the current IX? By calculating the voltage across the capacitor, and then from the capacitor voltage, I then look at the circuit when the switch is thrown, and then I solve that problem. So here we go. What we said here is I asked you, without any calculations, to try to build intuition here, figure out if you think the capacitor is going to charge up or discharge. And what we said here is that we said that the capacitor would discharge. When I have this thing as an open, I have this current and then this current from the 4 volt that's feeding that capacitor, and we're expecting that that increases the voltage. When the switch is thrown, it shorts off the 4 volt source. So the only thing feeding the cap then is that 4 milliamp. Therefore, we think that it's going to discharge. So now we go through that process. Step one, we determine the initial velocity of the cap. So using simple circuits here, we saw that there's only one current in the loop. Right, because that guy and that guy's in series. So as I come through here, we saw that the current, that 4 amps, because these two resistors are in parallel, and they're each 4, they're going to divide that 4 amps into 2 milliamps, each branch here. So using that idea here, we talked about, if I put my ground here, I know that node is 4 volts. If I have a current flowing through here, I know that that current has to be what? It's going to be 4 amps here, so I'm going to get 2 times 4, which gives me 8, so therefore I get a note of 12 volts right there. Since I know that this current is flowing in here and it's not divided, as I said earlier here, then that node relative to the ground, if that's positive and that's negative, then that has to be negative 4 volts. So then the difference between these two gives me 16 volts. So now what happens? Switch is closed. When it's closed, it kills off this whole branch. Here it is. So when I look at this circuit here, I want to determine the Thevenin parameters. Our goal here is to convert it into a Thevenin circuit. So as we do this, what we're seeing here is, once again, this circuit has only one current source. So therefore, if this is 4 and this is 4, it's got to divide that by 2. And then you can see that these two guys are in parallel. So if they're in parallel here, then that means that the voltage VOC must be the same as that 2K. So again, because that's 2 milliamps, I get a 4 volt drop, I got my VOC. So as expected, we said what? That the cap was going to discharge. It started at 16 volts and went down to 4 volts. So the jump is 12 volts. So when we calculate the solution for VC, we should see a step of plus 12 in the equation. So then we gotta determine RTH. So I open up my source, no dependent sources, so I don't have to calculate high short circuit. And when you look at this, we saw that we have 2 parallel to 4 plus 2. So I get a 6 parallel to 2, which gives me 3 halves. So now I got RTH. And then 1 over tau is 1 over RC. But the way I typically calculate them, I don't typically put them into my calculator unless I absolutely have to. So I just start calculating numbers. So I raise everything to powers. So I know I have a 3 over 2 kilo, so you can see me write 3 over 2 times 10 to the 3. Then the capacitor over here is 100 microfarads. So 100 is 10 to the 2. Micro is 10 to the negative 6. So when I do, that's 5 minus 6 gives me 10 to the negative 1, which is 10. So when I bring that 10 to the negative 1 up here, it's 10. Then I bring the 2 up, so then it gives me 20 over 3 hertz for the time constant. Yes?
When we're determining RTH, we're like using method 1 of the time.
Because there's no dependent sources. But you're going to see that you'll have some dependent sources in your homework. Then you would be calculating high short circuit. Okay. So now, what I'm left with, I calculated everything, so what do I want to do? I want to go to this. So here I go. So let's look at the voltage of the cap here. So if I look at the voltage of the cap, what we're seeing here is that this VOC is 16. So I'm going to write 16 plus. Then I get VOC. Ooh, that's not right. VOC is 4. So then I got to write 4. Then VC 0 minus, which is 16 minus 4, times 10 to the minus 20 T over 3. So when I look at this guy, this is going to give me 4 plus 12 E to the minus 20 T over 3 volts. So as expected here, we expected a value of 12. Why? Because there's a step of 12 going from 16 down to 4. So when I draw my, if I was to draw this guy here, you can see that the guy comes in like what? It comes in at 16 volts. And then what it does here is it decays. You can see that as t goes to infinity, this decays down to 4 volts. So if I look at this line right here, this would be my 4 volt line. You'll see that this guy decays from here to there. Now what we're seeing also is that we're also seeing that, what does that number 12 mean? It means that there's a jump or a decay of 12 volts. And so this red curve is given by that guy right there. So that red curve is that equation right there. Okay. So if you were to do this in piecewise, what would you do? You'd come in and you'd write 16 volts as your initial condition. And then you would see it go from here down to there. If you don't give that initial condition, you won't get that equation. You won't get that graph. Okay, so now what we want to do here is that we now need to solve the circuit problem. So now that I'm armed with this equation for the voltage of the capacitor, I go back to the original circuit. So I would say that this is the original circuit right here, right? We reduced these resistors right here. We've gotten rid of the voltage source. All I got to do is I got to add the cap back into that circuit. So now I have this guy. And so this is 4K, 2K, 2K. And then I have this guy right here. So I now have my BC. So when I look at the circuit here, if I want to solve for this current, I think I call this current IX, is that correct? Yes. I need to solve for that current IX. One of the things that you could see here is if you're not seeing this, what I would expect you to do here, draw nodes. Draw nodes, so I need to calculate IX relative to VC here. So we want to calculate IX relative to VC of T. And when you look at that, you can see that I have only two nodes between these two elements. So therefore, these guys are in parallel. But you can see here the polarity of the current is flowing this way. But when you look at that, you can see that there's a sign difference between the two. So if they're in parallel, I have to put in by hand that negative sign. So I'm going to see that the current IX is going to be minus, right, opposite polarity. Then it has to be VC of T divided by its resistor, which is 2K. Just using Ohm's law here. So then if I do that here, I'm going to get that minus sign here. And then look at that. I'm going to divide everything by 2 now. Okay? I'm going to divide everything by 2. And the currents are now going to be written in milliamps. So I'm going to get 2 into 4 is 2. 2 into 12 is 6. So then I'm going to get minus 2 plus 6 e to the minus 20t over 3. In units of milliamps. And that's the current IX right here. So now, let's plot this and try to interpret this thing here. So when I plot this guy, what do I know here? If I look at this IX here, there is a time before the switch was thrown. So if we go back to the circuit here, we agree that at VC, at 0 minus, we could see that this current across the 2K was 2 milliamps. But relative to the sign here, it's negative. So that means here that this is minus 2 milliamps when T is at 0 minus. After the switch is thrown, it jumps to this guy right here. So when you look at this guy here, it's going to go 2 plus 6 e to the minus 20t over 3 at T equal to 0 plus. So when I look at this here, let's draw the circuit out here. Not the circuit, excuse me, the plot. So I'm going to plot this. Plot IX versus T here. So when I plot this thing here, what am I seeing here? Well, at 0 minus, it's at minus 2 milliamps. So I'm going to come in here and I'm going to say, okay, here's minus 2 milliamps. And then at 0 plus, what I find here is I get this equation. Now let's see if we could just I it. At 0, that exponential here is e to the 0, which is 1. So then I'm going to get minus 2 minus 6, which gives me minus 8. So then what happens? This circuit then tells me that there's a discontinuity jump here. Right? So if I look at this, this guy's going to come all the way down here to minus 8 volts. And then you can see here that this guy is then going to do what? Decay back to minus 2 milliamps. So then if I look at this line right here, this guy then does this. And what is this equation? Well, this equation is what? IX equal to minus 2, 6 e to the minus 20 t. So this is plotting IX of T for all times here. So, does this make physical sense here? Well, what do we really know here? What we really know here is that we know that, so let's try to interpret this. So what we'll see here is that we know that VC of 0 minus and VC at 0 plus must be the same. Is that true? Well, if I look at VC, we said here, we saw that VC here was 16 volts. And then, if I take my equation for the capacitor here, you can see that at t equal to 0, I get 4 plus 12, which is 16 again. So in each of these scenarios here, we get 16 volts. One of the things that we've talked about a lot in the previous chapter here is that the voltage of cap cannot change instantaneously. But IC of T does change, right? It can change. As we saw circuits that where it didn't change, but this can change. What I'm saying here is that in general, I'm not putting my zero minus here, IC of zero plus is not the same. So let's check this out here. So if I look at IC here, it has to be what? C dV dt. So if I look at my numbers here, what do I have? Well, for C, we saw that C was what? 100 microfarads. So I'm going to put that as a number now. So if I have, let's put it up here. So if I have 100 microfarad, that's 10 to the 2 times 10 to the negative 6, which gives me 10 to the negative 4. So I'm going to write 10 to the negative 4. Now if I take the derivative of my value, I got to take the derivative of this guy here. So then I'm going to get 4 plus 12 e to the minus 20 t, 3. And then afterwards, I got to set t equal to 0. So I got to take the derivative and then set t equal to 0. So if I look at this guy here, I'm going to get, this guy is a constant. So I'm going to get 10 to the negative 4 times the quantity 0. And then I'm going to get minus 20 times 12 divided by 3 here. So that 3 divided into 12 gives me 4. So I get 4 times 20 gives me 80. So I get 80. And then I'm going to set E to the power of 0, which gives me 1. So what I'm seeing here is that this current here is then going to be what? 80 times 10 to the negative 4, which is the same as what? Minus 80 milliamps for the current of the capacitor at 0 plus. So did the cap change current? Well, let's look at this guy here. So what we're seeing here is that we're seeing IC of T. And we're seeing that at this point right here, right, actually, can I rewrite this just a little bit? I'm going to write this as minus 80 e to the minus 20 t over 3. Okay? So what you're seeing here is that when I calculate this guy, I'm going to get some type of exponential decay. But what is the current of the cap beforehand? When the switch has not been thrown, it has to be 0. Right? It has to be 0. So what you're seeing here is that the current of the cap is coming in at IC of 0 minus, and of course, that guy equals 0. And then there's a sudden discontinuity here where it jumps where? All the way down to here. So it makes a jump all the way down to here, which is minus 80 milliamps. And then what does it do? It just decays back to zero. So what we're seeing here, yes?
Nearly times 10 to the 4 is maybe 8 milliamps.
Yes, thank you. I like multiplying by things apparently. So I'm going to take, no, that's it. Okay. So then I'm going to get minus 8 million. So what you're seeing here, even though the voltage of the cap cannot change, the current through the cap is changing, which then forces that current to change instantly as well. And I'm seeing that this continuity right there. Okay, let's move on. Are there any questions before I move on? Yes.
Does it always work out that the current over the resistor current that it's not seeing? Because the current over that resistor jumps too.
And only because these guys were in parallel. So what we want to do now is we want to go towards the inductor. Let me erase the board. Any RL circuit and convert it into a Norton circuit. So regardless how complicated the RL circuit is, we're always going to be dealing with the Norton circuit. So that means here that the Norton circuit has to do what? It has a current source, which is I short circuit. I'll have a resistor in parallel. And remember, the Norton resistance is the same as the Thevenin resistance. And then I'm going to have my inductor like this. So regardless of what this circuit looks like, we're going to always get it into that form right there. So I'm going to pick the exact same circuit that we did last time for the capacitor. And that is that we started with the voltage source. And we had three resistors. But now I'm going to replace the capacitor with an inductor. And then I'm going to have a switch that looks like this here. So you can see I could write this 1, 2, 3. And here's L. And our whole goal here is to calculate what is the current of the inductor as a function of time. This is what we're after right here. What is that inductor? And we're going to assume that we close the switch at t equal to 0 here. Now, this is not a course in physics 4B. But a very, very common thing that's shown in fact, I've never seen this done actually in a circuits book, is that they'll use voltage divider rule, KVL, to actually solve this problem. Right? So for example, if I was to go and calculate this guy here, we're going to open this guy up and put a short here. That short will kill this 3 ohm resistor, and then people sort of like do a KVL loop around this thing. That's actually not correct. And I'll see if I can explain it a little bit, but we want to be careful how we handle this. But I'm probably going to do the very wrong thing and just say, we're going to do it anyways, even though it is incorrect. And I'll make sure that you'll see what I mean by that. But I'll only do it once, and then I won't do it again after that. So what we're interested in, we're interested in determining IL of t for, we want to know what that value is at 0 minus, right? Just like we did. VC is exactly like that. Then we want to know at 0 to effectively 5 tau. So that means for this, we're looking at this time right here. That's what we're most interested in. We're most interested in the transient period. That means it has gone almost to its final steady state value. It's not there, but it's 99.3% there. And then finally, we want to know what IL is at t equal to infinity. And according to this here, when this goes to a short, it kills that resistor. We can see that the final steady state value of the inductor must be I short circuit at t equal to infinity. That's what we're interested in. So what we'll do here is that we'll sort of like try to talk our way through this thing here a little bit. But before we get to the chase here, so what we're going to see here is that the solution to this circuit is IL of t. So there's a mathematical solution that we want to go after. It's going to be I short circuit plus IL of 0 minus I short circuit e to the minus t over tau. Okay? So that's the solution that we're going to get at the end. And remember, the way I interpret this solution is this is the mathematical solution. But the physical solution, I write like this here. I write as IL 0 minus e to the minus t over tau plus I short circuit of 1 minus e to the minus t over tau. And I call this sort of like the physical solution. Okay. This one's easier to deal with mathematically. This is the physical one.